समस्त जन कल्याणी निरतम करुणामयम् नमामि चिन्मयम् देवम् सद्गुरुम् ब्रह्मविद्वरम् सद्गुरुम् ब्रह्मविद्वरम् वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं। वेर देर इज डिजायर देर इज एक्सपेक्टेशन। वेर देर इज लव देर इज एक्सेप्टेंस। सो वेर देर इज डिजायर देर इज एक्सपेक्टेशंस एंड वेर देर इज एक्सपेक्टेशंस डिसअपॉइंटमेंट इज नेचुरल। Because we may not get what we desire, but in life we certainly get what we need. When we accept that with the acknowledgement that whatever is provided to us, whatever comes to us, is the gift of the Lord, the universe, nature to us. And what we do with it is our offering. When there is this mutual receiving and offering, there one attains not just goodness or the fulfillment of one's desire, but one attains shreyas. One attains excellence, which not only brings happiness to you, but also to many. When we understand this principle of the Bhagavad Gita, that where there is false expectations, disappointment is natural. Expectations come from our likes, dislikes, desire, and our insistence on getting something the way we want it to be, and therefore attachments. Where there is ego and selfish desire, there are expectations, likes, dislikes. And in all such condition, while we do the actions, there is anxiety for the result. When the result comes, if it is the way we wanted it to be, we are excited and we get further attached, to make it into a repetitive process of again and again trying to get that finite joy from the result or fruits of our action. Such a mind not only remains agitated, but also limits itself. With such a limited mind and agitated mind, our performance cannot be efficient, and our desires for the fruits are huge. Our expectations are large, but our performance becomes weak. To perform efficiently, one requires not just talent or skill and a readiness to act and the spirit of doing the best. But where there is equanimity of mind, when the mind is quiet, from that quiet, unagitated, disturbed mind, the best performance takes place. Whether it is in our profession or any action that we do, even the so-called mundane actions, in that there is a glow of excellence. When we act in that spirit of acceptance rather than expectance, when the mind is free of the anxieties for the result of the actions, such a mind which is calm, and calm mind has also got intelligence, because there is clarity of thinking, and with such a mind, when we perform our actions, or when we meditate, or when we are listening to the Guru to get that knowledge which transcends our mind and intellect, the knowledge of that which transcends our mind and intellect, that calm, pure, vigilant, intelligent mind is required for that final leap into infinitude. The word yoga, throughout the Bhagavad Gita, Sri Krishna has tamed it to make us understand its clear implications and made us understand how, in a simple manner, it can be achieved. We only follow some particular path or technique as yoga. But in different places, Sri Krishna has defined yoga. And those definitions are not contradictory definitions. Yoga, that comes from the root word yuj, to unite, to yoke, has got in its practice many implications. Krishna has said in different places this meaning of yoga. We find also different paths called as yoga because they are to unite us. Unite us with what? The different paths, whether we say the path of action, the path of devotion, the path of knowledge, or the path of Ashtanga Yoga, all of them are to unite us. What? Unite us with what? Our true infinite nature. That is the highest state of yoga. When having heard the knowledge of the truth as pointed out in the scriptures from a realized master or from the guru who knows and is established in the truth, and our mind no longer wavers with doubt or wavers away from that infinite goal and abides in it, that is called as the state of yoga. To achieve that state, what we require is equanimity of mind. Samatvam yoga uchyate. Mind is calm and peaceful when there is equanimity. An equanimity is there, calmness is there, when we are neither excited nor are we disappointed. And that is possible when expectations are low and acceptance is high. This clarity that we have, then we will understand that when Krishna points out that this is yoga, Krishna says in the beginning of the sixth chapter, summarizing all that he has said, so that we be clear in our practice. And before he starts the theme of meditation, which is mastering the mind at the subtler levels, we also know those who play sports that with your exercise, with your training, with your work and putting in your effort, practice, regular, punctual practice, discipline, with all that, you can bring your performance to a certain level. After that, when you want to participate in high level of sports, not just for even competition, but in such competitive sports where you have to break world records, you have to exceed the excellent record of the previous time, there the journey is not just physical, the journey is mental. How much have we developed our mind, our confidence level, our inspiration, our faith in ourselves and our goal, and the possibility that nature has provided to make it happen? Grace of God, faith in that. All these mental developments are required. And when the mind is calm and focused, when there is single-pointedness, that mind is a powerful mind that can even make this body, which seems to be conditioning, or we consider it to be limited, perform beyond its present limitations. And we can cross that threshold of our limitations. Very often, our self-imposed mental limitations. If you have to understand the spiritual instructions, if you have to understand what yoga truly is, And the teachings of the great masters and the teachings of Sri Krishna, who has explained so beautifully in the Bhagavad Gita, the very techniques along with the philosophy, the logic, the understanding. Once we understand this principle, that whether we want to excel in this world or exceed all excellence in this world to attain the infinite, then we have to master this mind. How to master this mind? That when we do our bounden duties, there is no wavering. Duty is something that we have to do because of the responsibilities that we have taken up. Therefore, first instruction is Niyatam Kuru Karmatvam. Do your bounden duty. You might say that I do my duty, do your duty out of gratitude. Then you do your duty for the benefit of the maximum that you can do. When you do that duty in that spirit of cooperation as a yajna for the well-being of everyone, not only the inspiration is higher and you go beyond your present motivation, inspiration, because your motivation and inspiration is higher, you go beyond your present expectations of yourself and from the actions that you do, and you magnify the result of your own actions for your benefit as well as for the benefit of the maximum. Therefore, Bhagwan's, Krishna's message throughout to Arjuna from the starting to the end, that do your duty, but do your duty for the sake of dharma, to create harmony, peace, synergy in the world, to flow with the rhythm of the world. And when there is a higher and nobler goal, and at the same time, there is dedication, and dedication is born out of devotion. And therefore, when we do our actions as a form of offering, love offering, to the lover of the universe, to the intelligence behind the universe, then not only every action gets a glow of excellence, but we transcend our limitations to exceed each time our own excellence. Therefore, Bhagwan summarizes in the beginning of the sixth chapter, Anashrita karma phalam karyam karma karoti yah sa sanyasi cha yogi cha na niragnir na chakriyah. He says that one who can do his or her action not depending on the fruit of actions to drive the person to action. One who does one's bounden duty, not with just some finite, limited, temporary expectations, such a person indeed is a sannyasi, free from the changes of the world. And such a person indeed is a yogi. And as we said, beautiful definitions of yoga is given. That equanimity of mind is yoga. And only when the mind is not affected by the changes and the pairs of opposites of the world, pleasure and pain, joy and sorrow, censure and praise, success and failure, but works for a higher goal, such a person, the mind becomes steady. That which creates in our mind likes, dislikes, agitations, when they diminish or are reduced, when we act in the spirit of karma yoga, the mind becomes calm and single-pointed. At this moment, between our knowledge and our mind, likes, dislikes, and desire, there is a split. The intellect understands and holds high ideals, but the mind, through the pleasures of the senses, slips back to its extrovertedness, its dissipations, its agitations. And therefore, this mind, how do we master it? First and foremost, keeping a check on our senses. Not that we shut down our senses, but what we see, how much we see, what we hear, how much we hear, how much we indulge in our senses, in the sense objects, how much and what do we indulge in is important. Yet the split between the intellect, which knows what is right, wrong, good, bad, and the mind's likes and dislikes, which creates this split. And thus, we cannot be focused, single-pointed, accepting because of this split. When we do our actions in the spirit of karma yoga, this union between our mind and intellect takes place. This is called as yoga. And such an integrated mind and intellect is fit to get the subtle knowledge of the truth, of the infinite, of the supreme. Otherwise, a split mind and intellect, agitated, guilty, frustrated, struggling, inefficient, is not capable of having that single pointedness, that contemplative and meditative mind, which is required to transcend our limitations. Even in our actions or performance, but the limitation of our own equipments, the gross body, the subtle body, and the causal body. To transcend our ignorance, to transcend our limited belief patterns, to transcend the compulsion of our likes, dislikes, and desires, this mind we have to master. And such a person is a yogi, a meditator. And in meditation, when we are able to withdraw the mind at will from the sense objects and the senses, and keeping that mind calm, peaceful, present in the moment, such a mind, when contemplates on the nature of the self as one with the infinite, call the infinite as infinite, call it as truth, call it as supreme happiness, call that as God. Because we have, the believers have got a certain concept of God. The atheists deny a certain concept of God. But what is the truth that we need to meditate upon? That so beautifully has been explained in the Upanishads. But Sri Krishna brings it to us in the form of the most digestible milk from the essence of the Upanishads. And therein we recognize what is it that we call as the infinite, and how this entire universe functions with such excellence. How do we recognize that excellence within ourselves? And as nature, as God, each moment exceed excellence, each time be anew and create each time a wonder. This is what Sri Krishna explained, and therefore says, lift yourself by yourself. Do not underestimate yourself or look down upon yourself. Uddharet atmana atmanam, na atmanam avasadayet. Atmaiva yatmano bandhu, atmaiva ripuratmana. You yourself are your best friend. You yourself are your deadliest enemy. You yourself can free yourself, and you yourself can bound yourself. But we think we need help. And yes, even to get that help, when we have devotion for the Supreme, grace flows in abundance. What is that love that is all-pervading? What is that devotion? Bhagwan Shri Krishna explains so beautifully in the Bhagavad Gita that probably there is no such book of knowledge which gives us how to live in our life moment to moment in love. Today we have explained the beauty of the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita. Pujya Gurudev dedicated his entire life to bring to the entire world this knowledge. And his work continues, and we all, in that spirit of gratitude, should work towards spreading this maximum happiness to the maximum people in the lifetime that we have. And therefore, Gurudev made this mission to give us a vision to serve. And I am, over the years, so thrilled with our various centers, but particularly UK, London, where we have our Chinmaya Kirti. And over the years, the activities that have been expanding and growing. And I'm also very happy to announce that Chinmaya Kirti at Hendon is about to take up the work for expanding its capacity to accommodate more activities, more people. I would request all of you to come forward to make it happen. When we feel gratitude and we want to make offerings of our Guru Dakshina, let it be out of our abundance for this work, which even Shri Krishna says that there is no greater seva, because all seva arises from this one vision, that there is only one infinite Atma, one infinite Self, one infinite God in you, in me, in everyone. And therefore Bhagwan says in the Bhagavad Gita, Sarva Bhutastam Atmanam Sarva Bhutani Chatmani, that one whose mind is Yoga Yuktatma, one who is of harmonized mind, sees the Self abiding in all the beings and all the beings abiding in the Self. Tasyaham na pranashyami, sacham me na pranashyati. And I am not separate from them, nor they ever become separate from me. And when that spirit, with that knowledge, we serve in the world, we share in the world, not only, as Bhagwan says, our personal growth takes place, but in the growth of the society, our growth, our happiness, our excellence exceeds itself. Tomorrow will be the last session of these talks, but as we've mentioned, that we will be having weekly classes on meditation. Please quickly register and join in so that that journey and the sixth chapter and the chapters of meditation of the Bhagavad Gita, its seed, its root is in the Kaivalya Upanishad. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Because you are here, I am talking. Therefore, I am grateful to you that you are making me talk of the glories of the Lord. Whenever you act in the world outside, wherever you are acting, if this is the attitude with which you are working in the world outside, there will be no karma bandhan, no shackles upon your personality. It will never create any mental inhibition. And when you are thus doing it, mukta sangaha, without attachment. Something like 82 times this word comes in the whole Gita. Without attachment, without attachment. Attachment means I plus I want. Mukta sangaha, without this idea of I and I want. Selfish desire without these two. Samajara. Do it as perfectly as you can. Each day is a competition between yourself and your yesterday's performance to improve upon it. Because what you are doing is serving Him. Samajara. Do it excellently. When you are doing a social work or a voluntary work, it must be done samachara. Do it in everything, excellence and perfection. Mukta sangaha, without attachment, without the vanity of I or I want. Last time when I came here, the lady was saying that I am going now to the hospital and console the patients, etc. You know, there is an organization that is doing it. I was congratulated her. This time, the first time I met her, the very first thing I asked, hey, are you still going to the hospital? No, Samji, I have given it up. I said, why did you give it up? Why did you give it up? Those organizations, they have got no sense of proportion. What is the matter? They are not sending me the jeep. And when I go there to the hospital, I work there 2-3 hours a day and they don't give me even a cup of tea. Everyone else they could eat and they did not give me that. It is for the jeep that you are serving. Is it for a cup of coffee you are serving? If you are serving there for a cup of coffee, you are cheaper than the porter. You are stupid. You are serving 3 hours for a cup of tea. But that is how they say. They did not give me even a cup of tea. They had a tea and they already took it, but they never invited me to take it. Therefore, I left it. That is not the spirit in which you serve. I want nothing. I expect nothing. I demand nothing. Only the pleasure of doing that right job in the right way. That is called worship. Those who are thus doing it in the yajna spirit, they do not create in their mind any shackles or chains of karma in themselves.
Close your eyes. We invoke it through the mighty, that we too may have all the values, strength, health, ability to fulfill this life, not only just to perform our present duties, but be prepared, be empowered to gain the knowledge of the Supreme. To gain this knowledge, mind must be at peace.
शास्त्र की